Sethuraman S. He completed his undergraduate studies from Tyagarajar College of Engineering. He pursued architecture with almost 5 years of practice and allied 3 years of professional architectural photography. He worked as an architect for Studio Kriya Architects Private Limited, which is a part of TVH Housing, Chennai. And he also worked for the architectural design group, ADG, headed by A.R. Dhanasekaran, Chennai. He's also worked for many other organizations like Design Cube Architects, Carbon Design Consultants, and AIM Associates previously.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series for BE Architecture. This is Building Materials 3, AR6304. This material section will largely deal with the main building components and the elements that go into it, right from what goes in the structure to the finishes to its external appearances and the elements that go with it. The first unit will be the requirements of ingredients for mortar, concrete. This is part 1, lecture 1. Concrete will be a major part of this lecture series. Concrete is nothing but a mixture of cement, sand, water and coarse aggregates. In this lecture, we will be talking about cement. So, this lecture contains a brief history, the definitions, composition, strength, properties, applications, manufacture, tests and types of cement. Throughout this lectures and the upcoming lectures, the thing is we will look at a variety of materials. So, in order to be able to cover each and everything and have an added interest and value to it, we will be looking at it briefly. Some cases we will look at the history, some cases we will look at the applications, and some cases we will look at the examples. Let's start with cement. It's always interesting to start with the history of any material or any concept for that matter. Cement, Assyrians and Babylonians were perhaps the first to use clay as cementing material. So, cement is nothing but a binding material. In order to build anything, we need to have a compact or a composite set of materials, which will be constituted by combining one or two materials. These materials can be combined only with the help of a binder. So, cement is one such binder. And even though the form of cement that is there today is very different, the concept of cement or the concept of a binder has been there from a very long time. So, as I said, the Assyrians and Babylonians were perhaps the first to use clay as cementing material. So, today we use cement, then we used clay. In ancient monuments, example forts, places of worship and defense structures, stones have been invariably used as a construction material with lime as the binder. So, if you looked at it, basic small domestic buildings could be built without binders, but as you go bigger and bigger with this increase of scale, one needed to use a composite set of materials and a binder was an important aspect in it. Records show that Egyptians have used lime and gypsum as cementing materials in the famous pyramid. So, you can date back to the use of binder materials or cement or cementing materials to the time of the pyramids. Vitruvius, as you all know, a very famous literary in terms of architecture, is believed to be the first to have the know-how about the chemistry of cementitious lime. So, lime was an important binding material those days, and Vitruvius seems to have studied it a lot and has also illustrated it in his book of 10 rules in architecture. One of the most notable examples of Roman work is the Pantheon. So, you've all heard about the Pantheon, you've studied about it in history and also in principles of architecture. The dome of the Pantheon is actually made of a composite set of materials and it's actually a concrete. It's a composite of two or three materials bound together by lime. So, a huge dome of that size was built by the use of concrete. So, as I said, it consists of a concrete dome. This is the Pantheon. So, the use of cements or the use of binding materials dates back to the age of Romans and Egyptians. Calcareous cements used by the Romans were either composed of suitable limestone burned in kilns or were mixtures of lime and pozzolanic materials. Residual materials from volcanic residue such as volcanic ash, volcanic rocks and lime were an important source of binding materials. Joseph Aspidine was the first to introduce Portland cement in 1824, formed by heating a mixture of limestone and finely divided clay in a furnace to a temperature high enough. The evolution of binding materials have come from one stage to another. The most important stage or phase in the development of cement is the discovery or rather the invention of Portland cement. Portland cement is nothing but cement which was very much resembling to the actual natural occurring cement or binding material found in Portland. So today, any standard cement is called as Portland cement. It was formed by heating limestone and finely divided clay. So from just mixing two materials and adding it as binding, we moved on to heating it and forming more better mixtures. In 1845, Isaac C. Johnson invented the cement by increasing the temperature at which the mixture of limestone and clay were burnt to form clinker. So initially it was just mixture of two materials, then it went on to increasing the temperature by heating, and then a final method was formed which is followed up till today. Crushing of various materials and then heating it up to form clumps of little rocks or clinkers which was formed, and then breaking this clinker into nice fine coarse material is how cement is actually made. So let's go into the definition of cement. Cement is a general sense, in a general sense, are adhesive and cohesive materials. So a composite material, they bind materials which are capable of bonding together particles of solid matter into a compact and durable mass. Cements used in construction industry may be classified as hydraulic and non-hydraulic. So we look at how cements from being just binding material have been further varied and characterized to suit various needs. The latter, that is non-hydraulic cement, does not set and harden in water such as non-hydraulic lime or which are unstable in water. Example, plaster of Paris. So cement have been divided into various categories, mainly being hydraulic and non-hydraulic. Hydraulic meaning when you add water to that cement, it hardens. So this is an important characteristic or property of this cement, which makes it a very good binding material. Non-hydraulic is the one where the use of water is not exactly a good way to use it. The hydraulic cement set and harden in water and give a product which is stable. Portland cement is one such. Portland cement, as we were talking about, is a cementing material resembling a natural stone quarried from Portland in UK. Portland cement may be defined as a product obtained by finely pulverizing clinker produced by calcining incipient fusion, an intimate and properly proportioned mixture of argillaceous and calcareous materials. So what actually happens is you heat two or three materials together, it forms clumps of rocks or what is called clinkers. These clinkers are broken down into very fine material by use of admixtures which act as catalyst, and this is how the cement or the basic Portland cement is formed. So cement can be manufactured either from natural cement stones or artificially by using calcareous and argillaceous materials. So again, we move on to the manufacture of cement. It can be manufactured with the help of natural aggregates or with artificial aggregates. The example of natural cements are Roman cement, Pozzolana cement and Medina cement, and those of artificial cement are Portland cement and special cement. We now move on to the composition. It's important to understand the composition of any building material, because when we look at the composition, the various properties give you the characteristics of what makes it that particular building material and how it is being used in various methods and various needs. So the composition of cement. Three constituents of hydraulic cement are lime, silica and alumina. Lime, as you know, silica is nothing but sand and alumina. In addition, most cements contain small proportions of iron oxide, magnesia, sulfur, trioxide and alkalis. All these chemical compounds play an important role, small or big, whatever, in giving the character of the particular cement. There has been a change in the composition of Portland cement over the years. As I said, a material evolved from stage to stage, and this change being mainly reflected in the increase in lime content and a slight decrease in silica content. So the lime content and the silica content can be varied, and as of now the lime content is higher than the silica content in the present form of Portland cement. Another raw material is blast furnace slag. So we use residual or waste blast furnace slag, which consists mainly of lime, silica and alumina, and is mixed with a calcareous material of high lime content. The proportions of the above compounds vary in the various Portland cements. As I said, cements are varied a little bit in terms and proportions and can be used for various other needs. The various constituents combine in burning and forming cement clinker. So as I said, cement clinker, the most important, or basically the cement in itself, is formed by burning the above listed materials. Compounds formed in the burning process have the properties of setting and hardening in the presence of water. So this is an important characteristic. Cement, after having gone through the burning processes, when exposed to water, have a characteristic of setting and hardening. So this is what makes cement what it is. They are known as Bogue compounds after the name of Bogue who identified them. So what happens when water is water is added to cement is there are compounds which are formed which give the characteristics to the cement. These compounds are called Bogue compounds because Bogue apparently was the one who identified them. So the ordinary Portland cement has been classified as 33 grade, 43 grade, 53 grade. So there are various grades for cement classification, and they are graded as per the compression strength mainly, and we'll see that in detail in the following. So we talk about the various properties and characteristics of cement. We talk about strength of cement, which is the most important property. So a strength of cement is primarily defined in three ways. So compression, tension and flexural strength. Compression and tension give the main characteristic of cement and its strength. So the compressive strength of cement is tested by making cubes of cement and testing it for compression using a vibrating means. So a very common test used for testing cement or to test its strength is called as the cube method, wherein you add a cement to a cube and add water, a mold cube, and this cube makes cement set. So as soon as you expose it to water, it begins to set, and the setting of this cement and its hardening and the various compounds it releases and gives the character gives you the quality of the cement. Tensile strength also yields an indirect indication of the compressive strength. So tensile strength is nothing but an indication of the compressive strength of the cement. We move on to further properties. Obviously, it is always desirable to use the best cement in construction. Therefore, the properties of a good cement must be investigated. So, we do get various grades of cement, various types of cement, but we need to understand the purpose in which we are going to use the cement and thus also make sure that it is the best suited for the purpose. So, desirable cement properties may vary depending on the type of construction, as I said. Generally, a good cement possesses the following properties. It provides strength to masonry. That's the most basic requirement of cement. So, when you have two or three composite materials, we need to put them together and make sure that they are strong and stay in place. Stiffens or hardens early. Not only does it have to set or harden, it has to also do it in a certain given amount of time such that it suits the construction conditions. Possesses good plasticity. So, plasticity of the cement in order to bind these materials is very important such that it doesn't crack or shrink. An excellent building material. So, this forms an excellent building material. It's easily workable. So, workable is nothing but how the ease of the cement, the composite material with which we can handle it, with which we can set it and with which we can shape it or replace it. And it should also be moisture resistant. So, moisture resistant is a very basic requirement of any binding material. So, these are the properties which indicate how good a particular cement is. So, we talked about the properties, the characteristics and the strength of cement, and now we move on to applications. So, these strength and characteristics give you an idea about where it can be applied. Cement mainly is used in making concrete which is the most widely used building material and in fact the most widely used material after water in any case. So, apart from that, cement can also be used in various other uses and as a separate material in itself. Cement may be used alone. As I said, it can be used separately as grouting materials. Grouting is nothing but filling in, to be put in simple words. When you place tiles or when you add slabs of various materials, the joints are formed between two slabs or two tiles or two particular materials. The gap in between has to be greased and it has to be filled. This is called as grouting. So, cement is the only material that is used for grouting. Mortar is cement mixed with sand or crushed stone. So, apart from concrete, basic mortar, basic material composite of just sand and crushed stone requires cement. Mortars are used for binding bricks, blocks, stones in walls or as surface rendering. So, other than concrete making, it is used for binding two bricks together where a compressive strength is not necessary as such and it just needs to be a non-load bearing wall for example. Concrete is used for a large variety of construction purposes. So, the main component that goes into or holds concrete together is cement, and so it naturally is used for making a lot of constructional buildings. We now move on to applications of cement further on. So, cement as I said can be used to make other materials as well as can be used alone as a material in itself. So, mixture of soil and Portland cement are used as a base for roads. So, apart from being used for grouting and apart from use for building materials or binding materials together, it is used as a base material. It's used as a base for a lot of things from very basic as such as marble laying to that of road layings and runway layings in airports for example. Portland cement also is used in the manufacture of bricks, tiles, shingles. So, it is also used to make other building material units or construction units. These products are prefabricated in factories and supplied readily for installation. So cement is also an important constituent of these materials. Cement is used for making joints for drains and pipes. It is used for water tightness of structures. So like grouting, where you fill gaps or small gaps in between two building units, it is also used to fill or make the connections between two structures tight or enclosed. Cement is used where hard surface is required for the protection of exposed surfaces of structures against the destructive agents of weather and certain organic or inorganic chemicals. So, as we talked about the moisture resistant characteristics of cement, so when a particular wall or when a particular masonry unit wall is laid, cement can be used as a finish in order to prevent moisture from entering these things. It is used for the construction of important engineering structures such as bridges, culverts, dams, tunnels, lighthouses, etc. So, in order to construct buildings or more usable building units, we need to have a construction, basic construction unit, masonry unit, and then we need to have finishes, and then we need to have elements. But there are other structures which are basically just for utilitary purposes like bridges, culverts, dams, tunnels. Cement is very important in constituting the materials for making these things. It is used in the preparation of foundations, watertight floors, footpaths, etc. So, the extension of these uses is being laid to other uses such as foundation, watertight floors, footpaths, etc., and is also employed for the construction of wells, water tanks, tennis courts. So, apart from being used for base laying of roads as such, it is also used for many game courts. Water tanks in most of the houses are apparently made from cement, and lamppost, telephone cabins, roads, etc. So, lampposts are a very good example of using cement where it can be economically feasible also. Now, we move on to the manufacture of cement. So, understanding the manufacture of cement shows how the characteristics are particularly formed. We have a illustrative diagram of how cement is being manufactured. We will go through it very briefly and simply. So, if you look at it, we have a dump truck. It deposits the main form of material used for making cement, which is the limestone rock or the main rock particle. This is first crushed, and then the calcareous materials added, which is sand, silica and clay. This then crushed and ground together is put in through a set of temperature and heating. So, it goes through a kiln and then clinkers are formed. So, clumps of little rock kind of features are formed. These are called clinkers. So, clinker is the main base unit of cement. These clinkers then are put through further heat, cooled down, and then broken down with the help of a catalyst, for example, gypsum. And what we have in the end is cement. These are packed and then sent off to storage. So, this is a very brief way of how you can see the manufacture of cement. So, a manufacture of cement can further be classified as the wet process and dry process. Wet and dry, as it indicates, is just about the use of water and not. Other than that, the whole process which I just described to you is being discussed in detail now. So, these two processes differ in operation, but fundamentals of both processes are same. So, the processes are crushing and grinding of raw material, the mixing and material in proportion, then moving on to the heating the prepared mixture in rotary kiln, grinding the heated product known as clinker. So, clinker is formed and then we are grinding it, mixing and grinding of cement clinker with gypsum, the admixture which acts as the catalyst. So, grinding and crushing. In this phase, soft raw materials are first crushed into suitable size. This is done usually in cylindrical ball or tube mills. So, here I initially described the basic methods in which the process goes through. We talk a little more in detail about the equipment used. Then mixing the material. In this part, the powder limestone, which we crushed and powdered in the previous stage, is mixed with a clay paste in proportion. The mixture is then grounded and made homogeneous by means of compressed gas. So, as each stage passes by, you need to compress, you need to make sure the material is vibrated and does not form as clumps as such. The resulting material is known as slurry, having 35% to 40% water. So, here is where the basic difference between dry and wet process comes. Slurry is then introduced in rotary kiln with the help of conveyor. The rotary kiln consists of large cylinders 8 to 15 feet in diameter, and this whole process is kiln. Usually covers 2 to 3 hours. Then we move on to the clinker formation. The product which is obtained from the rotary kiln is known as the cement clinker. So, these rock particles, black, dark, grayish particles in the size of rocks or gravel, is called a cement clinker. Clinkers usually in the form of greenish black or grey colored balls. Grinding the clinker with gypsum, the last part before which the actual cement is obtained. The cement clinker is then air cooled. The required amount of gypsum is ground to the fine powder and then mixed with clinker. Finally, cement is packed in bags and then transported to the required sites. So this is how cement is manufactured. So once it is manufactured, it can be sent to various sites, but even as you get it as a consumer, you need to test the cement on site to make sure it is the kind of cement that you want to use for your particular kind of construction. There are various tests. We'll talk about two or three tests, but we'll just list it out anyway. Fineness test, soundness test, setting time test, strength tests, specific gravity test, consistency test, heat of hydration test, loss of ignition test. So we talked about cube and cement testing. That is nothing but the consistency test. So the fineness test is nothing but you test the fineness or the method of passing the cement through sieves. So there are three methods basically to test the fineness: the sieve method, the air permeability, and the sedimentation methods. The last two methods measure the surface area, whereas the first measures the grain size. The grain size or the sieve method is not that much used as the other two, because cement have the tendency to form clumps. So when they are in clumps, it cannot be as such passed through the sieve and tested for fineness. Consistency test, as we talked about earlier, the cube mold is the most common mode of testing the consistency of the cement of different batches. So what we do, as I said, we'll repeat that again. So you have a cube, you add cement, you add water, and you let it set and harden. So you test it through various days in the course of time. We can test it by compacting it or grinding it to make sure that it doesn't form air cavities or clumps. So if the cube is intact and doesn't go through when poked with a particular equipment, when it does not go through more than 5 mm, you can be sure that the cement is a pretty good one. So these are the ways in which you could test cement. Now we further move on to the types of cement. So as I said, the constituents of cement or the way in which it is prepared and the strengths can be varied in order to form various types of cement, which can be used for various purposes. We'll also again talk about a few types of cement in this case. One such cement is the rapid hardening cement. As you can understand from the name, it's the most important characteristic of it is rapid hardening. So what happens with cement when we add water to it is that it sets or hardens. This takes a particular amount of time, but in some cases you require the setting time or the hardening time of the cement to be very short. In such cases, we use rapid hardening cement. So the rapid hardening cement has a high lime content and can be obtained by increasing the C3S. The calcareous content is increased as such. The basis of application of rapid hardening cement is hardening properties and heat emission rather than setting rate. So RHC or rapid hardening cement attains the same strength in 1 day which an ordinary cement may attain in 3 days. So when we do the cube test, what happens is we test it over a period of 3 days. But what happens in RHC is it attains the same strength that cement does in just 1 day, so 1/3 of the time. So you can understand where this can be used, where there is presence of water or where you have to raise structures where water is present. We need the cement to set really hard, or in some cases where we have very short time, for example, in the construction of roads or air runways, we need rapid hardening cement. And it is also suitable for repair of roads and bridges. As I said, any requirement of short period of time, RHC can be a very good use cement. We move on to another type of cement, which is the white and colored cement. So apart from being very utilitarian purpose, cement also has aesthetic qualities, and this can be achieved by use of colored cements. It is manufactured from pure white chalk and clay free from iron oxide. So iron oxide, the oxides are what impart the dark color, and so that is being reduced. Grayish color of cement is due to iron oxide. So the iron oxide is reduced and limited below 1%. Colored cements are made by adding 5 to 10% coloring pigments before grinding. So just before the grinding process, you add coloring pigments such that it gets fused with the clinkers, and then when broken down, it becomes more of a colored or a pigmented form of cement. These cements have same properties as that of ordinary Portland cement and are non-staining because of low amount of soluble alkalis. So what happens is the soluble alkalis are very less. So when you add a stain or anything that stains is added or by mistake poured onto these cements, it does not stain as such. Sodium aluminum fluoride is added during burning, which acts as a catalyst. So usually we add gypsum in general cement. In this case, sodium aluminum fluoride is added as a catalyst. These cements are used for making terrazzo flooring, face plaster of walls, ornamental works and castings only. So you move on from cement just being a binding material to something that of that of an aesthetic material. So it goes into the making of terrazzo, small tiled layout of floors, plaster walls or stucco walls, ornamental works and casting stones. Another important type of cement is the waterproof cement, which is a very basic requirement in various construction settings as well as atmospheric settings. Waterproof cement is manufactured by adding stearates of Ca and Al and gypsum treated with tannic acid, etc. at the time of grinding. So you notice that all the cements, just before the grinding process is added, you can vary it by adding or reducing the various components, and it gives you a different characteristic of cement. So the most important property being it is resistant to the penetration of water. So this leads to its uses in being a water retaining structure facilitation. It can be used in tanks, reservoirs, retaining walls, swimming pools. Swimming pools use a lot of cement, but it's not the ordinary cement which we see in construction. There are various types of cement, and it is important to have waterproof cement for swimming pools, bridge piers, etc. Another thing is water repellent cement. So apart from being waterproofed, it also has to repel water in some cases. This is called hydrophobic cement. When concrete is being prepared, hydrophobic admixtures plasticize the mix and contribute to the formation of uniformly distributed fine pores in concrete as it hardens and thus enhances its frost resistance. So the most suitable cases are basements and for watertight concrete. With this, we come to the end of cement, which is actually a very wide set of characteristic constituent material. So the outcome of this lecture is that we get an important view of the component of concrete, which is cement and is the most basic form of construction, understanding the brief history of cement and how the characteristics are formed, understanding its various properties and various uses and applications. Studying the manufacture of cement and tests makes it viable to have good quality of cement in sight. Some exercises which you could try out on your own is have a case study of any site or a cement factory, where you can have a direct view of all the processes. You could also have a listing of various safety and hazardous situations. Cement has a set of hazardous concerns. Identifying various environmental impacts, as I said. Offering solutions to make cement a lesser impact. It could be a very good way of addressing the concerns. With this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.